Okay, hello and welcome to Unacademy, India's largest platform for online civil services education. I am Rajshekhar Reddy, and before starting today's lecture, I would like to tell something about myself. I have cleared the civil service examination in the year 2014, and I have 7 years of experience teaching civil services aspirants, and I am a BTech Computer Science graduate from JNTU Hyderabad. So this is briefly about myself. So my experience writing this examination, I hope, will be very useful for you to crack the exam at the earliest point of time. Okay, so to tell something about the Unacademy, so you are familiar with this. Unacademy is India's largest and finest platform for online civil services education. The Academy has made rapid progress over the past couple of years in the field of online civil services education. You can avail the best benefits of the Unacademy institution by downloading and subscribing to the Unacademy Learning App. So it is available on the App Store as well as the Play Store. So what advantages does a student get by downloading and subscribing to the Unacademy Learning App? So he will have live classes on a daily basis. So you can ask questions in these live classes, engage in discussions, chat with your educator and answer polls all while the class is going on. Okay. And you have structured courses on the learning app, so they comprehensively deal with the syllabus of the civil service examination. So the entire syllabus of the civil service examination will be dealt in the learning app. So and India's top educators at regular intervals conduct live tests and quizzes. These will be very useful for understanding your preparation of the civil service examination, and you have unlimited access to the content of the Unacademy. So you can watch these videos any number of times without any restriction, and you can watch them at the time and place of your choice. Okay, so these are the advantages which are not available at different offline as well as online coaching institutions. So these are not available in various offline as well as online coaching institutions. So this is the best part of the Unacademy. So as I've told you, India's best educators are teaching on the platform. So we have Roman Saini, Mrunal Patel, Mudit Gupta and others who design various courses which help you to crack the examination very easily. So there is one course which I have designed. This is a course on current affairs. There is a course which I have designed on polity. This is however available on the Unacademy Learning App. So please download the Unacademy Learning App and watch my videos. So the title of these videos are Top 50 Topics in Polity for Civil Services Prelims 2020. In current affairs, I have started a series called Top 200 Topics in current affairs for Civil Services Prelims 2020. Similarly, there is a course on international relations. So you can watch this course on international relations in the Unacademy Learning App. So the title is Top 50 Topics in International Relations. So please search for my name, Rajshekhar Reddy, in the Learning App, and you can watch these videos for free on the Learning App. Okay, so you need to subscribe so to have the best of access to the facilities of the Unacademy Learning App. You need to subscribe. So there are a number of subscription options available. For example, you can subscribe for 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, 12 months and 24 months. So a civil services aspirant requires at least 1.5 year of preparation. So it is better to go for the 24 month subscription because it offers a 67% discount. So the final transaction cost will be for 64,000, and you get an additional 10% discount if you use my code RRUPSC. So if you use this code RRUPSC, you get an additional 10% discount. So the final transaction cost will be 57,600 for 2 years. And you can convert this transaction into no cost EMIs if you have paid this through a credit card. So the coaching fee, so the fees here is much cheaper compared to a number of online as well as offline coaching institutions. You can make a comparative analysis. You can visit any coaching institution of your choice and compare the fees between Unacademy and that institute. Further, you can watch these videos throughout the year. So new videos will be uploaded throughout the year, and everything related to the civil service examination will be dealt on the Unacademy platform. So this is about the Unacademy. I hope you subscribe using my code RRUPSC. So let's crack it and start the mock test today. So today I'll be taking a mock test on history. History is to start. I mean, before starting today's mock test, I would like to tell something about the prelims exam. So prelims, as you all know, will have 100 questions. So from history, there will be some 15 to 20 questions. So assuming that there are 20 questions in the paper, so most of the questions will be from ancient India. Some 8 questions will be from ancient India. Some 7 or 8 will be from modern India, and 5 will be from medieval India. This is the usual strategy adopted by the UPSC. So usually they give more questions from ancient India. Next preference will be for modern India. Third will be for medieval India. And of the three components in history, it is modern India, which I think is the easiest component. So you should never miss questions in modern India. Never miss questions here. Okay. One more thing which I would like to tell you, this is something which I have already told you when we were doing the polity test series. So in polity, we will have some 15 questions, and you should never miss these questions also. You need to answer the questions on polity as well as modern India perfectly. And if you can do this, then you are 90% guaranteed of clearing the prelims. Okay, so please be thorough in these two components. It is very easy for you to crack the examination if you are very strong in these two components. Okay, so this is what I wanted to tell you. As a person who has consistently scored very high marks in the prelims examination, so I am giving you this advice. So focus on polity. So never miss any question in polity and modern India. Okay, so let us start the exam. So there are some 25 questions in today's exam. So I'll be reading the question. So there will be 25 questions in today's exam. I'll be reading the question and I'll give you 30 seconds to answer. Let us see how many of you can answer these questions correctly. So this is not an easy paper. This is actually a bit tough. So, but don't be demoralized. So try to make a guess also. So this is the period in which you need to make these guessworks. Okay, so let us start with the first question. So this is the first question. Bengal Volunteers is a revolutionary terrorist organization set up by whom? So who established this organization? This came to be known as a revolutionary terrorist organization. But who established this organization? Okay, let us see how many of you can answer this. So I'm actually watching here. Nobody has answered it. So the answer for this question is Subhash Chandra Bose. So Subhash Chandra Bose has actually established this organization. This is a very important question. Not many people know the answer for this question. So this is an organization which was established initially in the year 1928. In 1928, the session of the Congress was held in Kolkata. So to organize this session, they required some volunteers, and these volunteers were brought by Subhash Chandra Bose. Eventually, this organization became what is called Bengal Volunteers, and they are known for one act in the year 1930. So they have killed one person called Simpson. So three persons of this organization were involved in the killing of Simpson. They are Binoy, Dinesh, Badal. Binoy Basu, Dinesh Badal, and Dinesh Gupta and Badal Gupta. So these three persons were involved in the incident. So very famous. So this took place in the Writers Building, which is the administrative building of Calcutta. So very, very important. Not many people know this, but in this context, I would like to tell you, I have added some questions with respect to revolutionary terrorist organizations. So if we have not read about revolutionary terrorist organizations, read them thoroughly. You have to go through them thoroughly. So very, very important for your examination. So please don't miss any question on revolutionary terrorist organizations. Okay. So let us move on to the next question. Let us see how many questions, how many can answer this question. Okay, so what is the answer? So let us examine the statements here. So Bhagat Singh, convicted in the Lahore conspiracy case, was strongly defended by Muhammad Ali Jinnah. This is a correct statement. Jinnah was a secular person in the 1930s and 1920s. So in the Central Assembly, he gave a speech in which he strongly defended Bhagat Singh. So not many people know that Bhagat Singh was defended, not in the court, but in the assembly he defended Bhagat Singh. So he was involved in the Lahore conspiracy case, that is the murder of Saunders, an official who was responsible for the death of Lala Lajpat Rai. Then second question, Bhagat Singh was involved in the Kakori train conspiracy case. This is not the correct statement. The Kakori train conspiracy case was organized by other leaders of the HRA, like Ram Prasad Bismil, Ashfaqullah Khan, others, Roshan Singh, etc. So the second statement is wrong. The third statement, why am I an atheist, is correct. So this is one of the most famous works of Bhagat Singh. So please go through this work if you have time. So please read this pamphlet which was written by Bhagat Singh. So the answer for this question is A and C only. Okay. So let us move on to the next question. So if you have not read about Bhagat Singh, please go through this very, very important personality of the Indian National Movement. So you need to study about this person thoroughly. You need to study more things about Bhagat Singh, because the questions can be asked not just in the prelims examination, but also in the mains exam. Okay. So let us move on to the next question. Let us see how many of you can answer this correctly. Who among the following founded the Naujawan Bharat Sabha? Who among the following established the Naujawan Bharat Sabha? So what is the answer? So the answer for this question is Bhagat Singh. This is a straightforward question. If you have read something about Bhagat Singh, you would have answered this very easily. So this is an organization which has a leftist leaning, and it was organized by Bhagat Singh to encourage the youth towards the Indian National Movement. So this is an organization which was established by Bhagat Singh. This organization actually became the public face of HSRA, Hindustan Socialist Republic Association. This was designated as a terrorist organization or a revolutionary terrorist organization by the British. So this was working underground. But there was another organization called Naujawan Bharat Sabha, which also had most of the members of the HSRA, and this became the public face of the HSRA. So if you have not read about this personality, please go through this personality, very, very important for the examination, okay? Let us see, yes, some of you have answered this correctly, very good. So let us move on to the next question. Who among the following founded the Dayanand Anglo-Vedic School in 1886? So most of the questions in modern India will be factual. In fact, most of the questions in the prelims examination will be factual. So you need to concentrate on the facts. So the answer for this question is Mahatma Hansraj. So Mahatma Hansraj is the person who founded what is called the Dayanand Anglo-Vedic School. So this system, DAV schools, are spread throughout the country, and they are very popular. So the origin of these schools can be traced to the 1886, and they were established by Mahatma Hansraj. So this is something which you need to remember. Okay, so let us see the next question. So I have given you a journal or a newspaper, and I have given the person who is associated with that journal or newspaper. So is the pair correctly matched? So this is a straightforward question. Let us see how many of you can answer this question. So Tehli Tehzeeb ul Aklak, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, Udbodhan, Dayanand Saraswati, Bombay Chronicle, Firoz Shah Mehta, Al Balagh, Abdul Kalam Azad. So first statement here is A and D only. So yeah, the number is missing. So let us see how many of you can answer this. Okay, so what is the answer? So who started or who actively was involved in this particular journal or newspaper? So Tehzeeb ul Aklak was a paper that was run by Sir Syed Ahmad Khan. So this person is very famous. So if you have not read about this person, please go through this. So this is a wrong match. Udbodhan was not started by Dayanand Saraswati. It was started by Swami Vivekananda. So this is also a wrong match. Then we have Bombay Chronicle, which was started by Firoz Shah Mehta, correct. And Al Balagh, Abul Kalam Azad. Al Hilal and Al Balagh were started by Abul Kalam Azad. So the answer for this question is C. That is third one, that is C and D only. So if you have not read about journals, newspapers, that is press of pre-independent India, then you need to study this topic thoroughly. Very, very important for the examination. And even in the mains examination, they can ask you a question on the role played by the press in the Indian national movement. So go through the list of all newspapers, magazines started by prominent political leaders. This is very, very important for the examination. Okay, so the answer for this question is C and D only. So let us move on to the next question. This is also a same question. So I wanted to emphasize on the importance of this topic, and that is the reason why I have given you two questions here. So let us see how many of you can answer this question directly. Just a moment. So what is the answer for this? Let us see how many of you can answer this. So the first statement, so that is the first pair, is wrongly matched. So who started Mook Naik? In fact, this magazine was started in the year, or this newspaper was started in the year 1920. So a potential question for this year's examination, because it has been 100 years since this magazine was started, and it was started by B.R. Ambedkar. It was not started by Jyotiba Phule. It was started by B.R. Ambedkar. Navjeevan, however, is a newspaper which was run by Mahatma Gandhi, correct. Miratul Akbar was also something which was started by Raja Ram Mohan Roy. So who started this? So Sudharak was not started by Bal Gangadhar Tilak. It was started by Gopal Ganesh. Sorry, it was started by Gopal Ganesh. Okay. So So his complete name is Gopal Ganesh Agarkar. Okay, so the answer for this question is B and C only. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. Let us see how many of you can answer this question. This is a straightforward question. If you have read about the Indian National Movement, then you can easily answer this question. So what is the answer for this question? So policy of masterly inactivity is basically a policy of non-interference. So in the affairs of Afghanistan, so there was a fear among the British that the Russians might invade Afghanistan and they might come to the neighborhood of India. They always wanted to control Afghanistan, but there was one person, this person is Sir John Lawrence, who advocated the policy of masterly inactivity. So he said that British is not facing any threat from the Russians, so there is no need for us to actively interfere in Afghanistan. So this is a policy which was started by this person in 1860 and it continued till 1876 when it was reversed by a person called Lord Lytton. So Lord Lytton, who assumed office as the Governor General in 1876, reversed this policy and he started actively engaging in Afghan affairs and he started the Second Anglo-Afghan War. So very important for your examination. So policy of masterly inactivity was started by Sir John Lawrence. Very, very important. Let us see. I mean, I have not seen anyone correctly answering this question. So let us move on to the next question. Who among the following British administrators was accused of corruption and impeached but was acquitted after long trial? So impeachment proceedings were initiated against this person. He was also accused of corruption. So who is this person? Who among the following British administrators was accused of corruption and impeached but acquitted after a long trial? So the answer for this question is Warren Hastings. So Warren Hastings, who is the first Governor General of Bengal, was responsible for strengthening the British Empire in our country. But he was also accused of various other charges like corruption, misadministration or misgovernance, etc. So though proceedings against him were launched, he was later acquitted after a very long trial. So the answer for this question is Warren Hastings. Okay. So let us see the next question. So what is the next question? So who among the following viceroys, governor generals, was killed while visiting the convict settlement at Port Blair in the Andaman Islands in 1872 for the purpose of inspection? So I would like to tell you something which is very, very important. So if you have not read about viceroys and governor generals in detail, then please go through them. So study, read about the viceroys and governor general in detail. So you just, I mean, it is not sufficient for you to know the names. So knowing the names is not sufficient. You must know what are the events that happened during their tenure. So you must know the events which happened during the tenure of each and every viceroy or governor general who served India. So very, very important. So the answer, who among the following viceroys was killed? So there was only one viceroy, governor general, who has been killed in India. So this person is Lord Mayo. I think he was killed in the year 1872 and he was killed by a person called Sher Ali Afridi. So who was charged with murder. So this person is not that important, but you must know that Lord Mayo is the only Governor General to have been killed in Port Blair in Andaman and Nicobar Islands, and he visited the cellular prison. Okay, so very, very important for the examination. So let me move on to the next question. So the 10th question for today's examination: who among the following Viceroys, Governor Generals used to write poems with the pen name of Owen Meredith? So as I've already told you, you have to thoroughly study about Viceroys and Governor Generals of India. Very, very important for the examination. So you must know this. So there was a very infamous Viceroy or Governor General who used to write poems. So he wrote a set of poems under this name at the age of 25. So he became very, very famous for all the wrong reasons in our country. So his name is Lord Lytton. So Lord Lytton is the person who is also a well-known poet, and he wrote a number of poems in this pen name. So if this is the pen name of Lord Lytton. So as I have already told you, study about Viceroys and Governor Generals, very important for the exam. Okay. So let us see the next question. Which of the following treaties officially ended the Second Anglo-Afghan War? So which treaty brought an end to the Second Anglo-Afghan War? So in this context, I would like to tell you that if you have not read about the wars that have been fought by the British, so go through these wars, very, very important. So they have fought, I think, 4 Anglo-Mysore wars have been fought. There is this Anglo-Maratha wars, Anglo-Sikh wars, Anglo-Burmese wars, and the Anglo-Afghan wars. So if you have not read about these wars, so study about them in detail. Very, very important for the examination. So let us see the answer for this question. So which of the following treaties officially ended the Second Anglo-Afghan War? So this is Treaty of Gandamak. So Treaty of Gandamak, I think, was signed in the year 1879. This brought an end to the Second Anglo-Afghan War. So this was fought by Lord Lytton, and you must know that British acquired some territories from Afghanistan. So the frontier regions were acquired by the British after the Second Anglo-Afghan War. So I have already told you that the policy of masterly inactivity, that is non-interference in the affairs of Afghanistan, was launched by Sir John Lawrence, but this was reversed by Lord Lytton, and he fought the Second Anglo-Afghan War. So very, very important for the examination. Let us see how many of you have answered this. So very good, Akash. You have answered both these questions correctly. Question number 10 and 11. So let us move on to the next question. The Tebaga movement was a significant peasant agitation initiated in which of the following regions? So this was a very famous event during the last phase of the Indian National Movement. So where was this movement launched? So the answer for this question is Bengal. So here I would like to tell you that if you have not read about the peasant movements, please go through the peasant movements. Then we also have the tribal revolts. So these are also very, very important. So these two are commonly asked in the civil services examination. So they can be asked both in the prelims as well as the mains examination. So please concentrate on this topic. Very, very important. Okay. Let us see how many of you can answer this question. So we will move on to the next question. Who among the following launched a powerful agitation against Kulinism? Okay, very good, Neelam. You have answered the the question on Tebaga movement correctly. Okay, so the answer for this question is Rajaram Mohan Roy. Kulinism is a practice which originated in Bengal. So it is very infamous. So this was started, I think, by Ballala Sena. Ballala Sena, I think, in the 12th century. According to this practice, a woman can marry a person who is of the same level in the social ladder, or a person who is of a higher level. So in the social order, there will be various castes that will be placed. So a woman can marry a person of the same level or the higher level. She is not allowed. She is not allowed to marry a man who belongs to a lower caste than her caste. So Raja Ram Mohan Roy, who is the father of Indian Renaissance, was completely opposed to this practice, and he launched an agitation against this. So very, very important person, very famous also. So let us move on to the next question. Who among the following operated the secret Congress radio during the Quit India movement? So if you have not read about the Quit India movement, so please go through the Quit India movement. So you must be thorough in four movements. One is the Swadeshi movement, the other is the non-cooperation movement, then the civil disobedience movement, then we have the Quit India movement. Okay. So if you have read about the Quit India movement, you can answer this question easily. So the answer for this question is Usha Mehta. Usha Mehta was the person who organized the secret Congress radio, because most of the prominent leaders of the Congress were arrested by the British. So only the movement actually was leaderless. Quit India movement was a leaderless movement. It was inspired by the call given by Gandhiji, that is do or die. However, some of the leaders actually organized a secret Congress radio, and the most prominent among them is Usha Mehta. Okay. Okay, let us move on to the next question. Consider the following features of the Gandhi-Irwin Pact. Discontinuation of the civil disobedience movement by the Indian National Congress. Participation by the Indian National Congress in the Round Table Conference. Release of prisoners arrested for participating in the civil disobedience movement. So, which of these statements are correct? So, Gandhi-Irwin Pact is a very, very important development in the Indian National Movement. So, what is the answer for this? Yeah, I'm sorry, Neelam. I'm actually using my mobile phone for organizing this class. I have a power cut at my place, so I'm very sorry. I think the recorded version will be good, so please don't worry. Okay, so let us see the answer here. So the first statement, that is discontinuation of the civil disobedience movement by the Indian National Congress, this is correct. So they have agreed to suspend the civil disobedience movement. So they were invited for talks, that is called the Round Table Conference. Gandhiji participated in the Round Table Conference, that is the second Round Table Conference. So this is a correct statement. Second, participation by the Indian National Congress in the Roundtable Conference. This is a correct. This is a something which followed the first statement. Release of prisoners arrested for participating in the Indian in the civil disobedience movement. This is also correct. So all the three are correct here. So all of the above. Okay. So very very important for the examination. So if you have not read about the Gandhi-Irwin Pact, read this. Very very important. So let us see the next question. Who among the following defended Aurobindo Ghosh in the famous Alipur conspiracy case? Who among the following defended Aurobindo Ghosh in the famous Alipur conspiracy case? So the answer for this question is C.R. Das. So C.R. Das is the person who defended Aurobindo Ghosh. So this is one of the most famous trials in the history of pre-independent India. So Aurobindo Ghosh after this trial has left the national movement. So he completely left the national movement. Though he was the most prominent leader of the extremist movement. So he lost interest in the national movement after this trial. So this is something which is very important. So let us see the next question. Who among the following persons recommended a set of political reforms to be implemented after the First World War on the request of Lord Willingdon? So the answer for this question is Gopalakrishna Gokhale. Gopalakrishna Gokhale, one of the most famous leaders of the moderate section of the Congress, recommended a series of political reforms on the request of Lord Willingdon. And this came to be known as the Political Testament. So it was prepared, I think, in the year 1915, but it was released or published in the year 1917, and this formed the basis. Most of the features of the Political Testament were incorporated in the Government of India Act of 1919. So very very important for the exam. So please go through the Political Testament of Gopalakrishna Gokhale. So let us move on to the next question. Which of the following committees was set up to investigate and clarify the relationship between the paramount power and the princely states in AD 1927. So the answer for this question is the Butler Committee. So Butler Committee was appointed to examine the relationship between the Crown and the princely states. One of the important recommendations made by the Butler Committee is that the princely states should not be made part of the Union of India or independent India without their consent. Without their consent, they should not be made part of the Union of India. And this was the basis for the Indian Independence Act. Act of 1947. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. Flag Satyagraha or Jhanda Satyagraha of 1923 took place at which of the following places? Flag Satyagraha was organized by the prominent leaders of the Indian National Movement in 1923. the most prominent among them is Sardar Vallabhai Patel. So Sardar Vallabhai Patel organized the flag satyagraha, but where was this organized? So the flag satyagraha was organized in Nagpur. So Nagpur was the place. The prominent leaders of the Indian National Movement demanded the hoisting of the national flag on prominent buildings. So this was opposed by the British, and they had to carry out several rallies against the British. So a very important event which followed the non-cooperation movement. So let us see the next question. Sare Jahan Se Acha was a patriotic song written by whom? So who wrote this famous song Sare Jahan Se Acha? So, Sare Jahan Se Acha was written by Muhammad Iqbal. I think he has written this in the year 1904. Please check this. I'm quite sure that it was written in 1904, 1905. So, this person was a prominent member of the Muslim League, and he later supported the creation of Pakistan. He is known for his poems, and he is often regarded as the national poet of Pakistan. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. Who among the following founded the Indian Home Rule Society, India House, and the Indian Sociologist? So this is a straightforward question. If you have read about revolutionary terrorism, outside India, then you can easily answer this question. So the answer for this question is Shyamji Krishnavarman. So Shyamji Krishnavarman was the person who supported the establishment of India House. So this is a student house which was established in London. So it was a student house which was established in London, and it functioned between 1905 and 1910. The India House offered scholarships to students who wished to pursue their higher studies in England. And over a period of time, it became a hub for political activism. So finally, there was an incident, I think Madan Lal Dhingra, who was one of the members of the India House, killed, I think, Wiley, Curzon Wiley, I think is his name. So this actually ensured that the British government focused on this organization, and they spread to other countries. So they left England and they went to other countries to carry forward the Indian National Movement. So they mostly went to France and Germany. Some of the prominent persons of the India House or the Indian Home Rule Society are Shyamji Krishnavarman. Then we have Madan Lal Dhingra, Veer Savarkar, Madam Bikaji Kama, Lala Hardayal, etc. Okay, so very important. So let us move on to the next question. Who among the following proposed a plebiscite to resolve the problem of a separate state for Muslims? So there was a very famous proposal which was brought forward by a prominent person of the Indian National Congress to resolve the deadlock between the Congress and the Muslim League. So the answer for this question is C. Rajagopalachari, very very important. So he suggested a scheme called, which came to be known as CR formula, and this scheme was used by Mahatma Gandhi while having talks with Jinnah. So Jinnah Gandhi talks were based on the CR formula. So CR formula recommended the conducting of a plebiscite in areas that had a Muslim majority. So areas where there is an absolute majority of the Muslim population will see a plebiscite. Okay. So let us see the next question. About which kingdom did Dalhousie say that it was a cherry that will drop into our mouth one day? This is a straightforward question and a very simple question. So the answer for this is Awadh or Oudh. So in 1856, Lord Dalhousie annexed Awadh under the doctrine of lapse. So this was one of the most infamous things which Lord Dalhousie has done. So he annexed Awadh on the ground of misadministration. And the head of, the ruler of Awadh was Nawab Wajid Ali Shah. Okay. So let us move on to this. If you have not read about doctrine of lapse, so please go through this. Very, very important for the exam. Let us see the next question. During the national movement, the Congress passed a resolution on fundamental rights and economic policy by way of a major concession to placate the left wing at which of the following sessions? This is a very, very important session of the Indian National Congress. So in which session of the INC was this resolution on fundamental rights and economic policy passed? So the answer for this question is the Karachi session. So the Karachi session of 1931 was historic. It was held in the background of the hanging of Bhagat Singh and the signing of what is called the Gandhi-Arvind Pact. So it was overshadowed by other events, but this session is one of the most important sessions of the INC. So it was presided over by Sardar Vallabhai Patel. So S.V. Patel was the president of the Indian National Congress. So he presided over the Karachi session. Then in this session, there was a resolution on fundamental rights, and there is also a resolution on the other social and economic policies of the Congress. And this later on the basis for the directive principles of state policy. So there are a number of principles of the social and economic resolution which were incorporated in the directive principles of state policy. Okay, so let us move on to the next question. So the last question for today's class, I think I have repeated this question, I'm sorry. So who among the following suggested a set of post-World War I constitutional reforms which came to be known as the political testament? So the answer for this question, which we have already discussed, is Gopal Krishna Gokhale. So Gopal Krishna Gokhale was the person who presented a set of political reforms to the British, and these formed the basis for what is called the Montagu-Chelmsford reforms or the Government of India Act 1919. Okay, so this is about the mock test today. So I hope it was useful for you. So let us see. In the evening, there is one more test on current affairs. I hope you all participate actively in the exam. So please use this code RRUPSC. So when you download and subscribe to the Unacademy Learning app. So thank you for participating in the exam, and have a very good day.